This is the last chapter of module 4, Embedded Firmware Design and Development. So here we'll study about the design of firmware for embedded systems. These are the topics I will explain today, okay, covered in your syllabus. So first topic is embedded firmware design approaches. So there are two different approaches we are going to discuss about the design of the firmware, as well as about the languages, development languages of the firmware. So using which language you can develop, what are the advantages, drawbacks of the different languages to develop an embedded system firmware. Okay, then in more topic we will discuss, we'll compare C and embedded C and compiler versus cross compilers. Okay, so these are the four topics included in your the last chapter of the module 4. So we'll start from the embedded firmware design approaches. So embedded firmware. So I have already explained you, and even you have studied this about firmware in previous classes. So what is embedded firmware? So this is a software that is written using code. That is the code, right? Written using a programming language. So it is a software which we call as a firmware. Okay, which controls, right, various hardware peripherals of the embedded system and generate the response so that the embedded system serve the purpose it is developed for. Okay, this is a software which control, right, all the hardware peripherals, okay, present or components present in an embedded system, make sure that all those components execute or run whenever required. Okay, and make sure that those components which require input gets the input at proper time, the components which gives the output will be received at the proper time. So it makes sure that all the components in combination works and serve a particular purpose. So it is considered as the master brain of the embedded system. So this is a program or software, right, which runs all the components of an embedded system and makes embedded system serve the purpose. So it is called master brain of the embedded system. So now where will be that firmware going to store? I mean, we are going to store it in the memory of the embedded system. That is read only memory. Because when embedded system is developed, a firmware is also developed and stored in the read only memory, which cannot be altered. That is ROM, right? Read only memory. So whenever you turn on any embedded system, so all the code you have written or program you have written or software you have written, that is which firmware you have stored in the ROM, every instruction gets executed one by one. That program gets executed. So that is what we call embedded system is working. Embedded device is working. When I say remote is working, the program written inside the remote is executing. When I say CCTV camera is working, program written inside the CCTV camera is executing. Okay, that's it is called brain. Okay, now we are talking about the design of the firmware. So what is the most important thing of the design of the firmware? The firmware is the program, right, which is written so that it can control all the hardware components of the embedded system and properly make use of all those components at a relevant time. So designing the embedded system mainly requires the understanding of the hardware, product hardware. So what are the hardware components, peripherals are there in the embedded system you are going to develop? We write code to control all those hardware. So we should have a proper understanding of different hardware or peripherals that embedded system is going to include. Okay, and their configuration and register details. Okay, because registers are very important, because every components, right, can communicate using register memories, right, and also configuration, how exactly it works, right. So everything is required before designing a firmware. If you don't know details of every hardware peripheral that you are going to include in an embedded system, then you cannot write the program to access those hardware. So then here the step, right? What is the one intermediate step which to write a to think that what an embedded system has to do and to develop a firmware, right? That is designing, okay? Modeling, we call it as modeling. That means when there is an embedded system you're going to develop, okay, you collect all the hardware components required for that embedded system, maybe sensors, actuators, of course system core, very important, memory, right? All other components you collect it, and we design hardware of the embedded system. Now while designing the software, that is the firmware of the embedded system, okay, we simply don't start coding it, we don't develop the firmware directly. Instead of that, we will sit and think what the firmware I am going to write, what it has to do, okay, what is the working of the embedded system, how it should work, which component should work at what time, what are the input you are expecting from a component, what are the output you are going to, everything we will see, and we will see what is the purpose of the embedded system and how should it work. Now the theoretical explanation how embedded system should work, that will be converted into UML diagrams or flowcharts. These diagrams, right, helps in the development of the firmware. So right, finally when you start coding the program to run all the components of embedded system, that is the firmware, when you finally start developing firmware, before that you should have your designs, firmware designs, okay, that is called diagrammatic representations, which helps you to understand the purpose of the embedded system very well, and it gives an idea how firmware should be, what are the functionalities of the firmware. Okay, so we'll go to first topic, embedded firmware design approaches. What are the, there are two techniques, are there two different way to design an embedded firmware. Okay, so that is, one is using it's called conventional procedural. I'll explain this. Generally it is known as super loop model. Okay, one is using super loop model, one is the embedded system operating system based design. Okay, so that means clearly here you can understand that in the first approach there is no operating system, in the second approach there is operating system included in the embedded system. Now what is the main purpose of the operating system, we'll discuss when I'm going to explain embedded operating system based design approach. So initially we'll study a conventional procedural based firmware design approach, or it is called super loop model approach. So these two techniques are different path or way or different techniques in order to develop a firmware. Yeah, super loop based approach. Now so what is super loop based approach? See here, embedded system, entire working of the embedded system, okay, we imagine it as a story which has a starting, which has a ending, right? And we divide that entire story into different pieces or parts, and we keep, right, executing every part one by one. It is on the order. Okay, for example, I'll tell you how super loop based approach, how we can approach in this technique, super loop based approach, how exactly it works. Now you have to design an embedded system to automatically maintain water level in the water tank, domestic water tanks what you have, right? You have to turn it on, turn it off the water pump whenever it is empty or full. That manual work we will remove. We will develop a embedded system to fill water tank in our homes automatically. Now what are the hardware I am going to use? Is one is the sensors, okay, in the water tank, okay, at the bottom one sensor to identify that water tank is empty, one more sensor, right, on the top of the water tank whenever I fill the water, to make sure that I will come to know when water tank is filled, so that I have to turn off the pump. Then I will use a relay to turn on and turn off the water pump, right? Also I will use some circuit to identify whether there is electricity in the home, otherwise there is no meaning in switching on the water pump. Okay, so one more thing is I will check whether there is a water in the well, so that I can pump it on the pump it to water tank. Okay, there is a separate sensor in the well. Okay, well, now so these are the various parts. So how super loop based approach works, how the storytelling and dividing it into parts is works. See, how exactly this embedded system works. Okay, I will initially starting of the story. So embedded system should check, right, the bottom sensor kept in the water tank, to check whether water tank is empty. First step. Now water tank is empty. Okay, fine. What is the second step? I will check whether there is a water, enough water in the well so that I can pump it into the tank. If there is no water in the well, it is probably during summer or right, as for some reason there is no way to pump or turn on the pump. So second step, check the sensor in the well so that whether there is a water or not in the well. Third step, the story is continuing. So third step, I will check whether electricity is there in the home or not. Okay, so everything is proper. Fourth step, I will turn on the relay so that water from the well will be pumped into water tank. What is the fifth step? Fifth step, I will check the upper sensor in the water tank to make sure that water has been filled up. Right, tank is filled up. What is the sixth step? I will turn off the relay. That's the end of the story. Now, what is super loop? Do you really think that it is enough for an embedded system which automatically maintains water level in the home water tank to work only once? Right? Yearly, or whole life, once at the money the water tank fill up the saka? No. Means the work of the embedded system has to be repeated every time. Means embedded system every time has to check whether water in the tank is empty. What happens if water in the tank is empty again and again? Same story repeats. Right? Check the sensor, check the sensor in the well whether water is there, check the electricity, turn on the relay. When tank is filled, turn off the relay. Again. So this is called super loop. Means why it is called super loop? This is the most outermost loop in the, there is always an outermost loop present in the program you are going to write, that is firmware in the embedded system, because the work of the embedded system keep repeating. You just check, right? There is an calling bell system in your home. Somebody press a button outside the home, the calling bell rings a sound. Is it enough only once it sound rings the sound? No. When somebody else come and press the button, again calling bell button, again calling bell has to ring the sound. Means it is a never ending job. CCTV camera, it has to keep surveying. Right, your refrigerator just keep working, microwave keep working, right? Your TV remote has to keep work. So that is called super loop. Means the entire life itself, there is only one single story being repeated every time in an embedded system life. Okay, so that's what called super loop. Means if I write a program for your embedded system to fill the water tank automatically, okay, I will go through the sixth steps. I told a story, right? From this checking the sensor to check whether water tank is empty till turning off the water pump so that tank is filled and turn off the water pump. The sixth steps, right? All those steps has to be followed by each, right? In the same order. Did you get this? Without checking whether water tank is empty, I cannot directly turn on the pump. Means I cannot directly execute fifth step. I have to go step by step, and all these steps should be in order. And once all steps are executed, water tank is filled, I have to repeat the story because water tank may get empty once again. So whole life in embedded system, the whole life of the embedded system, the same story. It keep repeating. So what is super loop? That's a super loop. And what is super loop based firmware development approach? This is how it works. So you identify what is your embedded system, what are the hardware you are going to use, right? When they have to work, you write the procedure step by step, okay, in the order. So we code the program. What is my program now? So first step of the program, what is the first step program? I'll write a code to check the sensor level in the bottom sensor of the water tank, which indicates me when water tank is empty. What is the next continuation of code? Then I will write the code to check sensor in the well to make sure that there is a water. So next, what is the next continuation of the code? I will check electricity sensor to make sure that electricity is there to turn on the pump. So this is the code. I'll write a single program. Okay, I'll write a single program, step by step. Whatever the steps is there, because I cannot skip any step, I cannot shuffle any step. No random steps. Step has to be followed in order. And once all the steps are done, one outermost loop which repeats all the steps once again. So that is called super loop based approach. It works on steps. And what do we call those every step? We call it as task. In programmatically, we call it as task. Right? In my automatic water tank water level maintenance system, there are six tasks. In theoretical, I call it as steps. In programmatically, I call it as task. So how exactly it works? See, there is an example here, right? So first of all, they have written a firmware execution steps. I mean, how exactly firmware should look like, the story they have written. So initially configure the common parameter and perform an initialization of various hardware components, memory, registers. First step, that is, you know, right? So in every cooking program, what is the first step? To turn on the gas. That don't nobody tells, but that is a common thing, right? So here also, configuring and initializing all the hardware of the embedded system, that always the first step. Okay, then first task, check the bottom sensor of the water tank, right? Then second step, check the sensor in the well. Then next step, what is that? Check the electricity, whether electricity is there or not. Then turn on the water pump. Then one more step, check the upper sensor of the water tank, make sure that water tank is filled. Then one more step is, when water tank is filled, shut down the, I mean, turn off the water pump, or turn off the relay. That is one more task. And one more is jump back to the first task here. So the eighth one is jump back to the first task here. So it keeps repeating. That is called super loop. So that's how the program looks like. See here, on the right side, there is a simple C program they have written to make you understand, right? Of course, we can write a single program. If you think it is become very large, we can make a project with multiple programs, or we can write procedures and call write procedures here. Every procedure I'll write as a every task will be coded as a procedure, and we call each procedure one by one in the order, right? And there is a while loop. What is while one? It is always true. In the whole lifespan of the embedded system, it keeps repeating all these tasks in this order, right? So this is called super loop based approach. Okay, let us see some drawbacks, advantages of the super loop based approach. Since task running inside is an infinite loop, the only way to come out of the loop is either hardware reset or interrupt assertion. Means embedded system cannot escape from its repetition of the procedure. We have written always true, while condition is always true. Means it is a super loop, whole life, right, of the embedded system keep repeating again and again and again. Okay, so no ending. There are only two possibility: is either you have to shut it down, embedded system, right, or interrupts. So that's what it is called, a hardware reset, right? When you restart the shut down the embedded system and restart it, or you can reset it. That is the same concept. You can reset it manually or whatever, because of due to error or something. When it resets, it will come out of that infinite loop, super loop. Or interrupts are possible. Okay, through interrupts we can. Why? Because when you interrupts execution happens. When somebody interrupts the processor, what happens? Current execution stops. Right, it will go to the interrupts service routine, executes it and come back. So for a period of time, using interrupt, we can make embedded system come out of that super loop. Otherwise hardware reset. Okay, only two, there is a two way, okay, when to come out of the super loop in the this kind of approach, when embedded system firmware is developed. Okay, then super loop based design doesn't require operating system. See, this is, you should know, I hope you are studying operating system as well. What is the purpose of the operating system? What is the purpose of the operating system? To manage resources. The thing is to schedule the, okay, the scheduling is also the right word, schedule the resource or manage the resource. Because what happens is, when there are multiple applications are running, multiple programs are running, they might require same resource, like same sensor or same memory, right, or same output devices. Multiple applications may require at a time. So that's why to handle the clashes, right, we need somebody who manages the resources, who can allocate different resources for different pro applications at different time. Okay, that scheduling or managing the resources is done by operating system. That is the ultimate what is the requirement of operating system? That is the ultimate purpose of the operating system. Okay, to manage everything, so there will be no clash between multiple applications for a single resource. Resource management is the ultimate purpose of the operating system. Now, why do we don't require operating system in super loop based design? That is because super loop based design works on task. Every task is executed one after other. So there is no way that multiple tasks will try to acquire a single resource. Like task 1 and task 3, both makes use of, suppose task 5, right, where I have to turn on the relay, and task 7, I have to turn off the relay after water tank is filled. Now both cannot use relay at a time. Why? Because turning off the relay only follows the turning on the relay. Means when water pump is not turned on, no, we are not interested to turn it off. That's what I told. In super loop base, everything happens step by step. Every step has an order. Right? They are not shuffled, they are not randomly executed. So there is no way that resources utilization may clash between the programs, okay, or between the tasks. Every task wait for one particular task to finish, then a second task execute, and then third task. So since it executes one after other, there is no need of operating system. It is enough if you can know how to directly handle the hardwares and make use of those hardwares. Okay, this is a why we don't require operating system for super loop based design. Lot of theories are there. So super loop based design is deployed in low cost embedded products, and very important thing is response time is not critical. Means any embedded system where response time is not critical, in such case only we can go for super loop based design. Okay, what is time critical embedded systems? Okay, where time matters most. For example, your automatic braking system in your vehicles, right? A vehicle which detects object in front of the vehicle and automatically applies the brake. In such case, time is very important, right? Even if there is a delay of 1 second to apply a brake when there is an object in front of your car, definitely you will meet with the accident, right? So there will be a catastrophic, very dangerous impact. So that's why it is very time critical. That time we cannot go for super loop based design. Why? Super loop based design is kind of government office, right? Where everything should happen based on the procedure only, right? You cannot skip any step. Right, that's why it is very slow, isn't it? So that's time, very important. Okay, that's time critical. Right, for example, we have turned on water tank pump the water into the water tank. Okay, now water tank is filled. Okay, but we are waiting, right, to check the sensor. Right, next step has to be executed. What is that? Check the upper sensor of the water tank to check whether water is filled. If there is a delay, water will spill out of the water tank, but it's not a big deal. Right? It's not a big deal. Then we'll turn off the pump. Okay? Of course, it will never happen, but still, if it happens, there is no issue. But automatically applying brake in a car, if that system does not work within a given time, if there is no quick response, definitely there is impact on human life or impact on the vehicle. So if it is a time critical, you cannot go for super loop based design where every step is executed after executing a particular step. No strict order following must be there. In time critical, super loop is a strictly follows order of execution of different tasks. So that is what called it is not suitable for time critical. Okay, and it is only suitable for low cost embedded products. That is main reason is we don't have to involve an operating system here. Okay, here there is a few more theories they have explained. One is the advantage. What is super loop based design? Of course, it is simple. The approach is very simple. You should know what is the purpose of the embedded system. So you write all the steps to execute to meet that purpose. So it is simple and straightforward. Exactly right. Without any operating system. But what is the major drawback? Drawback is whenever you are executing a particular step or you are executing a particular task, if that task does not complete due to some issue, no other further task will be continued because there is a strictly maintenance of order of execution of task. So if third task is not being executed, it will stuck, embedded system will stuck there, right? It won't execute 4th, 5th, 6th task, remaining task. So that's what the major drawback, okay, it hangs up, right? If it hangs up, no other task will be executed. So another major drawback is a lack of real timeliness. That's what I told right now, I explained you, right? It takes much time, okay, you have to keep waiting one step after other. So that is the thing, okay, there is no timeliness and there is a chance that if a program, a particular task did not get executed very well, there is an error, there is a stuck or hangs up, no other task will get executed. Okay. So he says, author says, there is some corrective measures for this. Okay. Best option is use interrupts for external events requiring real-time attention. So that is, he has given an idea to overcome lack of timeliness. Okay. So the system is doing some task, but right now you want to system to do something else. Okay, stop there. Then we can use interrupts actually. Okay, that's the one. But it's not always can be used every time. Interrupts takes much time, and even interrupts is a simply waste of resources. That's it. Okay. We'll go to second approach. Okay, so other than super loop, we'll go for embedded operating system based approach. Means here we include an operating system in the embedded system. Okay, there will be an operating system. So why? Because these embedded systems are very sophisticated. The programs or firmware, we write for this embedded system, will have multiple tasks, parallel tasks. So there might be clashes in the utilization of resources between various tasks. Okay. And it might be very time critical. In such a sophisticated embedded systems, we should need an operating system which takes the in charge of executing various tasks at various time and allocating resources, okay, hardware resources to different tasks. If there is a clash, operating system will handle that fight for single resource by multiple tasks. So everything is done through operating system. This is exactly how it works in your typical computer system, like laptop or computers, right? So how do you write a software? Definitely there will be operating system, and for that operating system we write a software and make an application so that it can run in the operating system, right? In your laptop you cannot execute any application without the operating system. Everything should get executed under the in charge of operating system, so that everything goes smoothly, no clashes will happen, right? So similarly here also we use the operating system. Of course there are two types of operating system, you know that, general purpose operating system or RTOS. General purpose operating system is very generic, right? You can install and we can write application to run in that operating system, okay, so that embedded system executes. Or you can go for real time operating system if your embedded system is time critical, okay, like for example, one example I given, right, automatic applying brakes in the car. Okay, that time you can go for RTOS if it is very time critical. Otherwise, if it is a complex, then you can go for general purpose operating systems, any operating system like Windows, Linux, Unix, right? So this is the operating system based approach. Okay, so here firmware is nothing but one of the application which executes inside the operating system, and everything operating system and application, everything will be there in the memory of the embedded system. Okay, so we require drivers of this. I hope you know what is drivers, right? Right now most of the operating system in the market do not require any special drivers. But what is a driver? Because every hardware has its own way of communicating, like their own way of communicating. So there will be only one operating system, but multiple hardwares designed by different companies. So drivers for every hardware is nothing but, if there is a hardware, okay, there will be a driver program. A software or program is called driver because it communicates between operating system and hardware. Because the way hardware works is different, the language of the operating system is different, they cannot communicate each other. So driver is the one thing which converts, right, their language or communication technique, so that both everybody can, in two operating system as well as hardware, can understand each other. Okay. That's what drivers software. So if there is an operating system, we need drivers for every hardware connected to the embedded system. Okay, drivers are the programs or softwares. Okay, so real-time operating system. When there is a real-time operating system used, if it is a time-critical, embedded system is time-critical, we'll use for real-time operating system. Because your general-purpose operating system is slow and it do not give much attention to the time, right? So that's why, but in real-time operating system, it is strictly, right, accordance with your time. Means time is most important in RTOS. Okay. So here, RTOS gives a quick response. That's why in time-critical system, you go for RTOS. But RTOS allows flexible scheduling of system resources. Okay. Offers some way to communicate between the tasks, CPU and memory. So this is the operating system characteristics, or he has explained, that is RTOS. Okay, and some examples of RTOS. So that is about two different approaches for firmware design. Now we'll go for the second topic of this chapter. Okay, embedded firmware development languages. Okay, so what are the languages we can go use to develop a firmware? Okay, of course there is there are a lot of languages, programming languages, but here we categorize in only two way. One is assembly level language, that is the lower level language, and higher level language, all other higher level languages. Okay, so any language you can use to develop a firmware for an embedded system. Okay, so one is the assembly language, one is the higher level language. Okay, so embedded firmware can be a target processor controller specific language. What is the target or processor control specific language? So when you develop a firmware using assembly language, then you should know which system core, processor or control, what is that system core you are going to use. Because every system core, or generally I will call it as a processor or control, because most of the time we use either a processor or a microcontroller as a system core. So every processor and microcontroller have variations of assembly language. Means every processor or microcontroller have its own version of assembly language. Like ARM controller has ARM assembly language, Intel has its own assembly language, Motorola has its own assembly language. They all differ. So here target processor specific language means whenever you design a firmware using assembly level language, you should know that what is the which kind of processor you are going to make use. So in its own assembly language you have to write the firmware. Okay, even though you are writing in assembly language, there is various assembly languages. In higher level language, that burden is reduced. Okay, you don't have to worry about which processor you are going to use, because higher level languages are processor independent. Right, because they finally we have to convert that language into assembly language later, that we'll discuss. There is a third way of developing a firmware, that is mixing up assembly as well as higher level language, because there is an advantage, some advantage of higher level languages, there is some advantage in lower level assembly language. If we combine, we can extract the encash the advantages of both the languages. So can we mix up? Yes, we can mix up. We'll study it later. Now we'll study about assembly language based development. Okay, where we use assembly language to develop a firmware. But which assembly language? The assembly language of the processor or controller which we are going to use in the embedded system we are writing a firmware for. Okay, namma embedded system alli yava controller processor yava company do navu use martive aa company the assembly language la firmware baribeku, otherwise the processor cannot understand it, right? Controller cannot understand it. That is the one thing. Okay, so that's what he's saying. See here, assembly language and machine language are languages are processor independent. Depending on processor, their format vary. So one, the assembly language, assembly program you write for one processor do not work with another processor. Okay, so that is of that's why I call it is processor specific machine code. Okay, that's why so this is one point you should note on. If you're writing in assembly language a firmware, then you should know which processor you are going to use in the embedded system. So for example, if you write an assembly firmware in the assembly language, Intel assembly language, and by mistake if you use ARM processor in that, you have to rewrite the code. Okay, then in this slide he has talked about general format of assembly language. You know it very well, right? It will come up with an opcode, we call mnemonic, then parameters or the arguments, right? There will be two argument instruction, three argument instructions. So all those things, parameters. Okay, so we know this label, opcode, operands, comments. Okay, this is all about assembly language. Okay, they have introduced the assembly language, how exactly it looks like, all those things. Yeah, one thing they have discussed, if see here, when you write assembly using assembly level language, okay, if it is too lengthy, we can divide it into submodules. Okay, so what happens when you divide it into submodules? Those modules can be reused multiple times. So that is one advantage. That is the advantage is there in every programming language. Okay, So how exactly it executes when you write a firmware, whatever firmware or any programming assembly language, how is it that it executes? Here, this there's a source file. What is it? This is a one program and I have saved it. One program file I have saved. One more source file means if it is a program is simple, I will write only one file. If the firmware is very complex, definitely it will have multiple programming files. Okay, routines irbodu adu programs multiple programs we can combine. Okay, it's very common. When program is very lengthy, different persons will develop part of different programs, so it will be in different files. Okay, multiple programs. So one or more source files where firmware is written in assembly language. All source file are given to the assembler. See, the compiler is missing because compiler converts higher level language to assembly language. We are directly writing program in assembly language, so compiler is not required. Now every source file is assembled. What assembler does? It converts assembly level language programs into object file, that is hexadecimal code. We call it as object code or object. Yeah, this is a file which includes object code of the assembly language in the source file. So that is the assembler work. Okay, 1 minute. Yeah. So all the source files, right, where assembly language programs we have written, we'll pass it to the assembler and convert all source files into object files, means object code. Okay, then definitely we make use of various library functions, right, library codes. So library will be there, assembly library. Okay, these libraries are depending on the processor you are going to use. Okay, what is the use of linker? Its name itself, right, indicates linking. Means that when there are multiple files like library files, multiple object code files from multiple source files, all these are linked together. Okay, and then it will be combined and converted into one single object file, absolute object file. And that is where after executing linker, assembler converts every assembly language into object code. All object code to the related to the firmware, including library files, are linked together. It is called a linker. Okay, it creates a single object file that is again converted into machine code. Okay, so linker, the single object file which is written in hexadecimal, it will be finally converted to binary. It's very easy to convert hexadecimal to binary. That's right. So this is how it works when you write in when you write a firmware in assembly language. So here they have discussed how to create library files. Okay, how to create a library file. What is actually basically library is, when we write a assembly any program, right, we might require to use some code, a very general code, like for example finding out square of a number. So we cannot keep writing, it is useless keep writing code for finding the square of number. Instead, what we do is, whenever a language is developed, we also develop a library where some most commonly required code will be written as a routines. So we can simply call square of a number function from the library and execute. Like a C library, we have stdio.h, right, console input output.h. There is a library. Suppose if you want to square of a number, you can call a function in C. Where exactly that function is? It is in the library, already written and saved in the library. So that's a, so here they have discussed library file creation. And what is the purpose? One thing is, library is some kind of source code hiding technique, abstraction. It's called abstraction. What is that? Whenever we use square, finding square of a number, we directly use the function. We don't know how it is written, how it gets executed, how the function is coded, right? What is the logic behind it to find the square of number? We simply call a function, pass the number, it returns square of that number, isn't it? When I call printf, I don't know how exactly printf works. Whatever I pass, it will get printed on the screen. So it's called hiding. Okay. Again, they have discussed linker. What is the purpose of the linker? The same thing. It will convert. It will link multiple files of a program, including library files, and converts into a single program. Okay. Then object and hex file creator. Object hex file creator. Convert to hex file converter. The object code will be converted to hexadecimal numbers. And then it will be converted to finally machine language, that is binary. Okay. So here the advantages and disadvantages of using assembly language to firmware design. So advantages are here. Okay, but disadvantages are very important thing, because why we should not use assembly level language, or we should know what are the difficulties we are going to face if we use assembly language to design the firmware. I am not saying we should not use. We are going to use assembly language for firmware design in many time, many cases, but we should know its drawbacks. One is high development time. Assembly language is not handy, like it is not that easy, like higher level languages, right? You have written already, right? Lab programs in assembly language. We have studied computer organization, microprocessors, microcontrollers. Most of the assembly languages we have studied, programs we have studied. So assembly language comes with the mnemonics, with different instructions, parameters, addressing modes. First of all, it is not easy. Okay, so writing code takes much time. There are a lot of references we have to do. Okay, we cannot keep everything in our brain so that we can keep coding very quickly. Assembly language takes time. Okay, developer dependency. Right, when I explain lab programs, I explain it very easily because I have coded it. If I have borrowed it from somebody else, I couldn't have explained it very well. Why? I need extra time to read it. Because looking at the assembly language, I cannot understand. I have to go through every instruction. It depends on developer. Okay, the language written by one developer cannot easily modified or understood by some other developer. It takes time. And non-portable, we know that because every processor, microcontroller has its own version of assembly level language. Okay, so we cannot, it's not portable. The program, assembly level language program is written for one processor like Intel, cannot be used for Motorola processor. So that's a disadvantage. So if you are not interested to write a firmware in assembly level language, what is the other option? Of course, there is other option. We can write a firmware in higher level language, right? We can code the firmware in higher level language. Which higher level language? When it is come to embedded system, embedded C is the widely used higher level language for designing the firmware. Embedded C or C++ or Java, these are three main languages. Embedded C is widely used in the world to write firmware for assembly level languages. Now, what is embedded C? We will study the topic. There is a topic in about C and embedded C. So we'll discuss there what is the difference between C and embedded C. Okay, generally right now in this topic we'll call it a C program only. Okay. I hope you know what is which language is better, C, C++, Java. There is no way to tell which is better. It depends on the scenario, depends on complexity of the firmware, the purpose of the firmware, all those things. Right? What are the functionalities are included in the firmware? Depending on that, also depending on the developer, right? We have to choose either C, C++, Java, or any other languages for embedded firmware design. Okay. Now, how exactly it works when we write it in higher level language? The only thing is here, extra step included is compiler. Look at this. Instead of assembler, we use compiler. Why? Because it is higher level languages. That compiler converts any higher level language program into assembly. Did you get this? Now, instead of compiler, we have written cross compilers. So, what are the cross compilers? See, every processor have their own compilers. That means, every language has its own compiler. Right? We say C compiler, we say Java compiler, we say C++ compiler. But still, there is one more issue with that. It's higher level language. That compiler converts higher level language into assembly language. But there are multiple versions of assembly language for various company manufactured controller or processors. Correct? No. So now, how compiler converts higher level language program into assembly, but which assembly? There are various assembly languages, different version of assembly languages based on the processor company. Right, Intel bere, microprocessor, Motorola bere, ARM bere, yavudakke convert martave, that is the issue. That's why we introduce here cross compilers. We'll discuss compiler and cross compilers compare with in later. So here generally I call it as compiler itself or cross compiler. Why compiler introduced? Because it's a higher level language. It converts that compiler converts it into assembly language. Okay, but here since it is a cross compiler, it also does one more function, that it also, by converting it to assembly language, it goes one step forward, it converts assembly language into object code. ಓಕೆ ಎರಡು ಸ್ಟೆಪ್ಪನ್ನು ಕಂಪೈಲರೇ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಡು ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಕ್ರಾಸ್ ಕಂಪೈಲರ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಕಂಪೈಲರ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ಅಸೆಂಬ್ಲರ್ ಓಕೆ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೈ ವಿಲ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಆಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ನೋ ಅಸೆಂಬ್ಲರ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಫೌಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಇನ್ಸೈಡ್ ದಿ ಕ್ರಾಸ್ ಕಂಪೈಲರ್ ಸೊ ಹೈಯರ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಗ್ವೇಜ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ಲಿ ಆಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ರಿಮೈನಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಲಿಂಕರ್ ಇಟ್ ರೈಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಲಿಂಕ್ ಆಲ್ ದಿ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಫೈಲರ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಲೈಬ್ರರೀಸ್ ಫಂಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಲೈಬ್ರರಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ರುಟೀನ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೇಕ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಎಸ್ ಅ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಆಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಫೈಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಕನ್ವರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಹೆಕ್ಸಾಡೆಸಿಮಲ್ ಓಕೆ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕನ್ವರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಟು ಬೈನರಿ ಓಕೆ ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಹೆಕ್ಸಾಡೆಸಿಮಲ್ ದೆನ್ ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ಲಿ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಕನ್ವರ್ಟ್ ಈಸಿಲಿ ಟು ಬೈನರಿ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಮ್ಯಾಥಮೆಟಿಕಲ್ ಲಾಜಿಕ್ ಹೆಕ್ಸಾಡೆಸಿಮಲ್ ಟು ಬೈನರಿ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೈ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಶೋನ್ ಸೊ ವಿ ಕಾಲ್ ಮೆಷಿನ್ ಕೋಡ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಹೆಕ್ಸಾಡೆಸಿಮಲ್ ಕೋಡ್ ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಬೈನರಿ ವೈ ವಿ ಡೋಂಟ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಬೈನರಿ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಗಾಟ್ ಹೆಕ್ಸಾಡೆಸಿಮಲ್ ಓಕೆ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಫ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಕನ್ವರ್ಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಬೈನರಿ So this is how it works when we use higher level language. So advantages of higher level languages, definitely it should overcome assembly, disadvantages of using assembly language in firmware design. Portable. When I say I write a program firmware in C, okay, it doesn't matter which system core, which processor controller I am going to make use in my embedded system, because C language is higher level language. It is common. It's portable. Right? It is a worry of the cross compiler which convert it into assembly language. So programmer don't have to worry about portability. Okay, developer independent. Right? Okay, and development time is also reduced because it is very handy. I mean, the higher level languages are very easy. Right? Easy to understand, easy to remember. So we quickly code it. Okay, there are drawbacks here. For even some drawbacks are there with higher level languages while using it in development of embedded system firmware. So one thing is cross compilers available for higher level languages may not be so efficient. Okay, so when you write a higher level language program, you have to convert it into assembly. Now question is to which assembly? There are various versions of assembly. So cross compilers ask you whether you want to convert it into the assembly language suitable for ARM processor or assembly language suitable Intel processor or Motorola processor. Which processor I should convert that assembly language in support to? But since it has the capability of converting higher level language into any version of assembly language based on user requirement, it also lacks the efficiency with the cross compilers. Then investment required for high level language based development tools, because they do not come with open source most of the time. You need an integrated development environment, that is, we need editors, we need compilers, we need tools for testing. All those things are we need investments, because every time we don't get it for free. That is, we cannot make sure that all tools for higher level language program developments are free. Okay. The third approach. Okay. There are some advantages with assembly language. There are advantages with higher level language. Mixing assembly and higher level language and writing a firmware is widely used technique. Okay, widely used technique. If you are okay, that's how we develop embedded system in most of the time. Okay, now why it is combined is not because of their advantages. Of course, because of their advantages, but there is one more concept behind this. That see, higher level languages have their own capacity, or they have their own functions, routines in library. Okay, to do some tasks. Assembly language have few more library functions or routines. They have some other capabilities. The capacity of the writing code will get more functionalities. I mean, we'll get more features if you combine two different techniques, right? Suppose if I combine C programming as embedded C and assembly, then I'll get features of C as well as features of assembly language, right? Because C program has their own particular library function, assembly language has their own particular library function. I can use both. Features will increase, different features of programming language when you combine. Okay, so for example, I simple concept. See, assembly language is good in handling hardware. It is nearest to hardware, right? Assembly language, it will have more control. If you are an assembly language developer, you are developing a firmware in assembly language, you will have more control on hardware. Whereas if you go for C is easy to write, but there are no much features or functions in C to directly handle the hardware. Right? Directly memory access from a particular address, right? All those things. It's very complicated. Even other hardware components access is complicated. In assembly, it is easy. So we combining, we can get more features. But there is a three way to combine assembly and higher level languages. One is we write program in firmware in higher level language, but whenever we require, there we use some routines of assembly language, functions of assembly level language. But mainly we write it in higher level language. One more technique is we write entire firmware in assembly language. Wherever we find difficult, then we will use routines of high level language in between. But majorly we write everything in assembly. Wherever it is required, there only we use higher level language. Two technique. And third is the inline assembly programming. What is inline assembly programming? Here we write program in higher level language, and directly in the higher level language we don't have to call any routine of assembly. Assembly language functions are the routines call madbekantilla illi. Directly we write assembly line in the in between the higher level languages. Directly a line ondu. Okay, one direct line ane now assembly language barudbidodu. Okay, so here we call assembly language functions in first approach. I am writing a program in C and my assembly language library will be there. I call a particular function, okay, pass some parameters and get the return value. But here inline assembly means I am writing higher level language. In between C statement, I directly write assembly language statement. That is the instruction. Assembly language instruction, I will directly write. Okay, that's called inline assembly. Okay, so here they have discussed mixing of assembly language with higher level language. That is mean I have written a program in C. Somewhere I require some feature of assembly. I feel it is very easy in assembly. Then I call assembly routines. Okay. This is the steps, right? They have told, right? Here they have explained how to do it. Okay. Assembly code, how to mix assembly code inside the C. I mean with the C. Okay. You can go through it. Okay. There is no much explanation. One more technique is I am writing code in assembly language, and in between I am calling some C functions. For example, if it is a C, higher level language C, I'll call a C function for a square root. Assembly language do not have a library for example ARM assembly language. I'm using ARM processor, writing a firmware, designing a firmware using ARM assembly language. ARM assembly language do not have a square root function or routine. But C program do, right? It does have a C program function. So if you pass square root function, if you pass a number, it returns square root of that number. So I call that routine. But majorly I'll write, main program is I'm writing in assembly. In between, somewhere required, I'll call C. Okay, so that's how it works. And inline is a very easy, okay, and very easy because I keep writing higher level language program. Somewhere I think assembly language should be there, some particular instruction is there in the assembly to make it easier. Instead of writing lengthy codes in C program, I think in a single instruction I can do it in assembly level language. I directly insert that instruction in between of the assembly language, instead of calling routines or using library, I directly use instruction itself. Okay, so this is called inline assembly. So two topics are over. Third topic in this chapter is C versus embedded C. I don't explain much, this is completely theory, but I'll give introduction to this. What is C versus embedded C? We have know the C programming language, we know this is the advantage of C programming language, right? What are the features it has? Okay, one thing is very important thing is platform specific application, right? You see right here, 1 minute. Yeah, so here, see, when I write a program in C, okay, we have a compiler, C compiler, which converts C program into assembly language. Now which assembly language, whether it converts C program into assembly language suitable for ARM or Intel or Motorola, that depends on the which compiler, right, which compiler you are going to use, right, the platform operating system you use, so it will be converted into that particular understandable format, right? Okay, for example, you are using a Windows OS and C compiler will be there. You write a C program and it compiles C program so that Windows operating system can understand it. If you are using a Linux operating system and you have installed a C compiler, that compiler converts C program so that in a Linux OS can understand it. Okay, So it is called a platform specific development. Now what is the how to compare C and embedded C? There is no much difference. So C is a general higher level language, which is general purpose higher level language. Okay, embedded C has all the features of C, plus embedded C has more control or more features that so that we can have higher control over hardware, okay, or memory. So that's what he is saying here. So one thing is we need cross compilers. When you go for embedded C, we need cross compilers. Means if you write a program in C, it is just a compiler, right? Because compilers come for Windows, there is a separate C compiler. For Linux, there is a separate C compiler. But if it is embedded C, we have to use cross compiler. Means like Keel compiler. So what it does, when you write in embedded C, in a single compiler itself, it will ask option to which kind of assembly language you want to convert. There you have to give whether you want to convert it into the assembly language understood by ARM or Motorola. So based on your requirement, it will convert to that particular version of assembly language. Higher level language will be converted to that particular version of assembly language. So we need a cross compiler if you write an embedded C program. Difference is here. Okay, technical differences between C and embedded C. Okay, please read it. They might ask in exam. Okay. The last topic of this chapter is comparing compiler and cross compiler. See, compilers is directly one word which he explains you. It is called native compilers. What is native compilers? Native compilers means if it is a Windows, right? There is an operating system Windows, and you have installed a C compiler. Definitely, it will convert that compiler converts C program into assembly, which can be executed in Windows operating system. If the compiler you have installed in a Linux operating system, definitely it will convert C program into convert it in so that Linux can execute it. Means it's native, it's local to that operating system, local to that machine where you are going to install compiler. The compiler is always native, it's local. But cross compiler, no, it will ask the option for the user. Right, when you write a program and use a cross compiler to convert it into assembly language, it will ask user to which kind of version of assembly language you want it to be converted to. Right, I can select it. If you start a practicals in laboratory, when you use Keel compiler, we'll come to know. When you write a program, it will ask whether you are writing which Java processor use code martidira anta. It will ask to which processor you are writing this code. Whether ARM, whether Intel, whether it is Motorola, or if it is ARM, which version of the ARM, everything it will ask. So it is a cross compiler. Okay. So this is about this whole chapter. Okay, firmware design. So here we discuss two approaches of designing. Right. Either we go for operating system based approach or non-operating system based approach. That is called super loop. Right, then we studied whether which kind of languages we can use, whether we can go for assembly language, what is the advantage or disadvantage, or we can go for higher level languages, what are the advantages and disadvantages. Also I just explained you that we can mix C higher assembly language inside a C higher level language, or higher level language inside a assembly language, or inline assembly. When writing assembly higher level language program for firmware design, we can in the statement itself, I can directly write an assembly instruction, right? Then I explained you the comparison between C and embedded C, as well as compiler and cross compiler. So this is everything about this chapter. Thank you.